The scripture reading is from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 11, verses 28 through 30. Matthew chapter 11, verses 28 through 30. Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Please be seated and join me in a word of prayer. Father, we pray for our children, even as we dismiss them to children's worship. May they be able to worship you and learn from you and to grow closer to you as they are nurtured in faith. And we pray the same for us as we look to your word. Would your Holy Spirit speak to our hearts messages that we need to hear, challenges that we need to hear, and the comfort that we might need to hear. For we pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Church fatigue. Now that's an interesting sermon title, is from the many comments that I've received over this last week since it was published that I'll be preaching on church fatigue. And people have been asking me, what is church fatigue? And I keep telling them, the American Medical Association defines church fatigue as obviously, there's no defined definition of what church fatigue is, but I think maybe in our core of core, it's one of those things, you know it when you see it. And so, since I started getting the question, I began doing an informal survey of people around me, asking them, when you think of church, do you feel tired? And as a result of that survey, I can definitively say 100% of the church staff are tired. Then I went outside the church staff and began asking people, well, when you think of church, do you get tired? And most of the response was, of course, but there was also people responding saying, no, when I think of church, exactly the opposite. I feel rejuvenated by the idea of going to church. Now, if we're honest with ourselves, where are we on this spectrum between being weary and having church fatigue and being rejuvenated by the idea of our engagement in our church? No, it seems very obvious that over a lifetime of following after Jesus and being involved with his body, the church, we are going to hit a point when we are weary. It's weary being obedient to Jesus. And the Christian life is not an easy life. It's a pilgrimage life. It's a journey that demands a lot from us. And from the Old Testament to the beginning, we see the saints of God get tired, the prophet Elijah exhausted. We see Paul, the apostle of God, tired and worn down. We see even our Savior and our Lord Jesus Christ weary and tired. And so, don't get me wrong, in the Christian life, we can't expect to go through all of life without ever feeling weary or tired. And yet, I think there comes a point in all of our lives when we just look at the season of life that we're in and we do feel tired. For the most part of my life, I love going to church. The idea of being with brothers and sisters and just getting to sing the praise songs and the hymn songs, getting to study God's Word together, getting to just hang out in fellowship. There's no better place I'd rather be than at church in most seasons of my life. But there are also seasons in life where the idea of another Bible study, the idea of another prayer meeting, the idea of singing another hymn, where it kind of wears on your shoulder and goes, man, that just doesn't sound like it'll be rejuvenating right now. It just sounds like it'll be work. Earlier this spring, as a staff, as we were planning for the summer and the fall, we began thinking about all the new initiatives we wanted to do, let alone how we were going to sustain the current things that our church is doing. And we began talking about the need for volunteers. And as we began listing them, it was a little overwhelming. There are so many needs here at our church, and not only needs here at our church, but maybe even more needs outside the walls of our church. We need volunteers in so many places. Our youth pastor was talking about it. Our family pastor was talking about need for volunteers to work with children in the nurseries. We need volunteers to help with the greeting. We need volunteers to help with hospitality, the welcome tables. We need ushers. We need volunteers for Kids Week. We need new committee members on several of our committees. We need new small group leaders in our young adults group and in some of our community groups. We need new volunteers for our Thursday night homeless outreach. We need people to help with the media and sound each week. We need English teachers for our outreach to international students and scholars and the Friendship Bible Study partners and volunteers. And we need people to help organize all church Sunday breakfasts. And the list went on and on and on of the many volunteers that we need. Don't you just feel exhausted listening to that list? And this is just inside the walls of the church building. More importantly, or just as importantly, we need men and women to begin impacting our communities and our cities, to be witnesses in their workplaces, to initiate prayer and study groups in the marketplaces. We need volunteers for our many ministry partners to meet the needs of our city. And we need missionaries. Oh, how badly we need missionaries willing to go overseas to meet the needs of people who have yet to hear the gospel. This can get overwhelming when you look at the needs of the world and the needs of our church. On top of that, we were looking at our bulletin, and you see that in the area of giving, our ministry budget is 14% in the deficit, below budget, and our missions budget. Our missions budget is 24% in the red at this point of the year. The needs can get overwhelming. And as we sat around talking about what we were going to do, we began thinking through our summer preaching themes. And it seemed to be fairly obvious that we needed to preach on stewardship. Surely a bunch of messages getting people to give more and to do more, they surely couldn't help hurt, I mean. And we thought maybe if we could preach with a little bit of passion and inspiration and sprinkle that with a good dose of guilt, that would get the job done. But, you know, there was a problem with that. And the problem was most of us preaching over the morning while Gordon is gone, none of us really felt like we wanted to hear any messages about giving more and doing more. And we definitely didn't want to preach messages about doing more and giving more. My Baptist pastor friend used to joke, saying that the Baptists had reworked the famous nursery rhyme of Mary Had a Little Lamb, and it went something like this. He said, "We sing, Mary had a little lamb, it was hers to keep, then it joined a Baptist church and died for lack of sleep." I heard that and thought, we could sing that about Park Street Church. And so as we begin assessing where we were, as we were honest with ourselves, just the idea of asking for more, it just didn't feel right. And as a result of that, we came up with this sermon series on church fatigue. It felt like that might be a little bit more where we're at. And how do we deal with this church fatigue? We see it played out in church in many different ways. You know, we see it just from the exhaustion of programming and activities and events. And there's nary a time that goes on at our church when something's not going on from morning till night. Probably the most fatigued people at our church are our church facility staff from early morning to late at night. there's always activity going on and turn around and need for cleaning and need for new groups to come shuffle in and out. There's not a night that goes by at our church where there's not an important, substantial, crucial meeting or ministry happening. We see it all over church that we're doing too much and that even more needs to be done. We see it in serving fatigue. We see it in people who once found great pleasure in volunteering. And all of a sudden that volunteer service feels like work and labor. We see it in faith fatigue, that believing in God and believing in His promises all of a sudden becomes challenging and wearisome. And the idea of waiting upon God starts to wait upon us. We see it in compassion fatigue. Loving on people, which is what God calls us to do, all of a sudden it becomes burdensome. And there's more need for compassion and love than we feel that we have to offer. And obviously we see it in giving fatigue, where we are overwhelmed by the needs of too many good causes. We do have a little bit of church fatigue going on, don't we? Most of us live our lives at a pace where we are living at a pace that overstretches us and gives us little margin for rest in our lives. I mean, since coming to Boston 13 years ago, I've never met so many people who are so ambitious about getting so many degrees in this world. Right? We're always constantly thinking about the next degree we're getting. And it's not just the young people, it's the old people at our church who, you know, we're always pushing ourselves. And we see a lot of that at Park Street. You know, we are physically tired to the point that we have very little time to live healthy lives, very little time for exercise, for sleep, for the rest and solitude that we need, for time with family, and time for our relationship with God. I remember seeing an article a little while back, and it was writing about prognosticators from 50 years ago in the 60s. And they were talking about all these advances in technology that our society and our country was making. And their prognostication was that 50 years from now, because of technology and the advancements we would make in improving our productivity, that Americans would only have to work 20 hours a week. Just hasn't kind of worked out that way, has it? We're tired physically because of the pace of life that most of us live at. And we're tired mentally and emotionally. You know, an example of that is in the areas of family. As we've seen, the disintegration of marriages and families in our society, hasn't that taken an emotional and a mental toll on us? The repercussions of marriages breaking apart and families breaking apart, it takes a toll on us in every different generation. You know, as society has completely thrown off any of the kind of biblical morals about sexuality and the guardrails that the Bible has given us, we see more and more young adults who are frankly relationally dysfunctional, right? And that takes an emotional toll upon us. As we are living longer because of the good health that we have, our elderly are needing to make harder choices about retirement and about their own living choices. And we, for our parents who are living longer, we're blessed by that, but needing to be more careful about how we're going to take care of them and help them make the decisions that need to be made. All of these areas of family life, they began to become burdensome on us, and they take a toll on us. We're living in a time when people are financially more in debt than ever before, and that takes a mental and emotional toll on us. So physically, we are beaten down. Mentally and emotionally, we are burdened. But the primary topic at hand for today is the fact that many of us are spiritually tired and worn down. And as Jesus puts it in today's passage, we are laden with heavy burdens. As I was writing this sermon this week, in popped an email from one of our missionaries. And, you know, I was feeling pretty sorry for myself as I was making the list of all the things that needed to be done, and just thinking, man, as a church, I was feeling a little sorry for you all. We are weary and we are tired. And then pops this email from one of our missionaries, and it said urgent. And so even though I was working on my sermon, I decided to look at it. And then it was an urgent prayer request. And they were asking for a prayer for one of their national teammates in the country that they work in, whose mother had just been taken to the police station because of her faith in Christ. Neighbors had complained, and she was basically threatened to denounce her faith and told that the group, the house church that was meeting in her place, that they needed to stop, and they're trying to make her sign some statements. And as I began comparing the struggles that we have versus the struggles of so many other believers around the world, it did give me a little bit of perspective. And I had to pause and say, God, I don't want this message to be that of complaint, for we truly are blessed with the things that God has given us. And yet, when we look at today's message, there's a challenge and there's a comfort there, because we see two things going on in today's passage. We see Jesus giving a twofold invitation with the same promise attached to them both. And so, no matter what degree of weariness that we're in, whether we really are pressed and worn down and under persecution, or we really are just going through a bit of tiredness, or maybe you're not going through any of that at all, but I guarantee at one point you probably will. We see Jesus' invitation with the promise of rest attached to all of them. And I think rest is something that every believer in Christ and every single person in this world needs. And Jesus gives that promise of rest. He says, come to me, all you are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. And he goes on, take my yoke upon you and learn from me, from gentle and humble, and what? And you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy, my burden is light. Friends, every one of us, regardless of the circumstance that we are in, I think we need rest. And I bet that in your heart of hearts, you sense that you need rest. We see the sense of church fatigue come on in I think, two different ways. For many of us, it's as a result of a long time service to God. We've been doing this a long time, serving God, meeting needs, praying, worshiping, learning, and it becomes a sense of duty, and it becomes a sense, we do this out of a sense of obedience. C.S. Lewis, in his book Mere Christianity, compares the believer who does things out of duty like a man paying his taxes. And he says that, you know, even though the person pays their taxes, that it can wear on them and they become a pest at the end because they're doing it with the wrong motives. Oftentimes, don't we see it when we serve God and we go about doing things out of a sense of duty without understanding why we're doing it and without understanding how we are empowered to do this in Christ? Doesn't it lead to apathy and often disinterest and in worst cases, cynicism about why we are doing it? For others, it's not that we've been doing it over a long period of time, but it's because we're doing it with such an intensity. We jump into serving God with everything that we have. We enjoy that ministry. We want to love people. We want to volunteer and do something that's meaningful. And we go full steam ahead. And you know, that cliche of giving 110%. And we give all that we have. And all of a sudden, we find that we have nothing left to give. And that we're going on empty. And that we feel completely burnt out. And it seems like when we hit these cases of church fatigue, we simply want to quit. We want to draw back, and we want to stop doing it. And we're not quite sure what we want to quit, but we end up blaming it on the church. It's surely because the church has been asking too much of me that I feel this way. Jesus understands his sheep, and he understands that we all need a reset. You know, my tendency in life is that when I start feeling this way, when I start feeling exhausted, I just want to say to myself, John, stop complaining, suck it up, and keep going. And I got a feeling we got a lot of people in our church who feel that same way. When you feel worn out, you just feel like, I don't have the right to complain. I just need to keep going. As some of you know, that a few weeks ago, I did the fundraising bike ride from Baltimore to Boston. And I have to confess that I did not have nearly enough time to train as I should be. And most of the people who really knew me were surprised that I actually made it. And they asked me, hey, how did you do it? Just, you know, you weren't training and look at you. How did you do it? I said I just kept three words going in my mind over and over and over. And those three words were, just keep pedaling. Just keep pedaling. Just keep pedaling. And that's all it took to make it 415 miles. Just keep pedaling. And oftentimes in our Christian life, we think that that's all we got to do. We just got to keep going. Just keep going. Just keep going. And that might be sage advice if you're 96 years old and about ready to go meet Jesus in that glorious way. But for the rest of us, that advice of just keep going probably isn't the best thing we can do. And clearly Jesus looks at his hairy and weary sheep and he goes, no, don't just keep going. It's time for a reset. And so Jesus invites the weary to come to him. And he says, come to me, all you are weary, those who are laboring and tired because you're laboring. And then those who are heavy laden with burdens that you can't carry. And he goes, to you who are tired, I'm going to give you rest. It's an amazing invitation of grace for those of us who are weary and heavy burdened. And the context in which he makes this invitation is the ongoing conflict that he is having with the Pharisees, who are the religious people of his day. These were the religious leaders of the days. These were the guardians of the law of God. Religion at its core is the demand or the invitation to us to do what is right, to do what is good, to do what is lawful, so that we might be righteous, so that we might accomplish whatever God puts before us. And in a counterintuitive way, Jesus says, no, I'm rejecting the religion of the day. And rather, what I am inviting you to is into this invitation of grace, into this invitation of a relationship with me. The Pharisees were the ones who set out the law and made it clear to the people that if you want to please God, you needed to live by these laws and according to these laws. And this passage, it comes right before a conflict that Jesus is going to have with the Pharisees, arguing about the very core of what the law is about. Later in Matthew 23, Jesus says of these Pharisees who he's opposed to, he says, these Pharisees, they tie up heavy, cumbersome loads and put them on other people's shoulders, but they themselves are not willing to lift a finger to move them. The religion of the day, the people were weary because they were burdened by the encumbersome burdens of the laws which they were unable to keep, and yet they were told that they were to be strict with them. The people were spiritually tired, doing their best to follow God, but overwhelmed by the demands of the religion around them. And in stark contrast to this religion, Jesus invites the weary and the burdened with a promise of rest. Why are you and I weary today? Is it because we have bought into the same message of the Pharisees, the same message of the religion around us, the same message that we need to be doing and striving and doing even more and striving to be accepted by God, to be righteous enough by God, to be holy enough for God? I think many of us are weary today for several different reasons. For some of us, it's because we struggle with sin. We struggle with sin, and we would rather not struggle with sin, and we try our best to not sin. And yet, whether it's an addiction or whether it's small sins or large sins, we are under that burden of sin and try as hard as we can. We can't seem to break off that shackle and that burden of sin. And it gets weary, and we go, what's the point of trying when I can't become any better? And we forget that we are not judged by our sin, but by what God has done for us in Jesus. for some of us, we're not weary by our sin, but we're weary because of our own unbelief about that sin. You know, we can't overcome our sins, nor can we accept the fact that we're actually forgiven. I was rereading a biography of one of my favorite American heroes, Samuel Mills, who was one of the founders of the American missions movement in the early 19th century. And I was reading his memoirs, and he was a pastor's kid. He had grown up with a great sense of religion, a great understanding of the gospel, a great understanding of scripture. And he writes about a moment in his life, and he talks about there was a revival in his town when he was a young man, and he came under conviction. And though in awful distress and agony of spirit, I obtained no relief, he goes. What pained me most of all was the apparent discrimination of God's divine favor. For while others felt not only conviction of sin and the joy of the lifted burden, while I stumbled on in darkness and in despair. And so here's a guy who understands the gospel and he understands what Jesus has done, but he's weary because he can't believe that even though the scriptures say that God has forgiven him, he doesn't feel that forgiveness in his life, and he sees that in other people, but he goes, where is that forgiveness in my own life? How come I don't feel it? And he was burdened down with the guilt of that. So we are weary not only because of our sin, but because of the unbelief that comes in our lives. I think some of us are also weary because we compare ourselves to others. We look around us and we go, man, that person, they seem to have faith and life so put together. And we become envious of those around us. We begin measuring our own spirituality by the spirituality of others. Man, if I could just understand the Bible like Gordon. Man, if I could just pray like Chris May, if I could just, you know, lead a small group like Jeff Schuliger, you know, if I could, be as cool as our youth pastor. We look around, on me on staff or all the people around us, and we begin measuring ourselves against others around us, and it becomes wearisome because the fact is there are always people who are around us who are more spiritually mature, who are closer to God, who are doing better in their lives. We also become weary when we measure ourselves by what we do. When we begin to measure ourselves by our commitment to God, when we begin to measure ourselves by how much we serve, how much we give of ourselves, how much we give of our time, how much we give of our resources. When you look upon the demands of a follower of Christ in our church, it can get overwhelming, right? Come to church and be a regular Sunday attender. Give of yourselves. Give of your tithes. Volunteer. Be a part of a small group Bible study, right? We say that's part of the community. Volunteer in a ministry that's significant. Do something meaningful with your life outside or inside the church. We tell people, you know, you have to be a family man. You have to spend time with your kids. You have to be a good wife, a good husband. You have to be a good friend to those around you. You have to be a good parent to your children. And we haven't even started talking about, yes, and every day you need to do some quiet time and devotion and spend time in God's Word and spend time daily praying. And it can get overwhelming, right? This idea that we measure ourselves by all the things that we do for God. And many of ourselves find ourselves weary and burdened down by these measures that we have put upon ourselves. You know, there's another category of people who are weary too. You know, it's as weary as we are who serve God. I think it's even more weary for those who are still unbelievers. I love our sister Shauna's testimony, just talking about that sense of missing something. You know, as I've gotten to meet with her and talk to her about her story, it's just a stark reminder that for people who don't yet know Christ, as weary as we might be who know Christ, it is weary being outside of that place where you understand that God has rest for you. St. Augustine put it this way, Thou hast made us for thyself, O Lord, and our hearts are restless until they find their rest in thee. I think of so many of my friends who are restless because they are missing a savior and meaning in their life. And I know there are many amongst us who've been coming out to church. You've been coming out here for whatever reason, a friend, a boyfriend, a girlfriend, a family member has brought you, and yet you've been unable to put your trust in Jesus, unsure of what you believe, but still you're coming. And I'm guessing you are weary and you are tired and feeling burdened. And it's to you also that Jesus says, come and I will give you rest. When Jesus invites us to come to him for rest, he invites us into a unique relationship with him. He goes, take my yoke upon me and learn from me, for I'm gentle and humble in heart, and you'll find rest for your souls. Jesus invites us into submission and discipleship to him. He says, take my yoke upon you and learn from me. That word, learn, that's used in the context. The word in Greek is mathete, which is the same word for disciple. He goes, take my yoke upon you and become my disciple. What was a yoke? It was an agricultural term. It was a long beam that they fitted to fit upon the neck of draft animals, usually oxen. And a yoke was used to harness them, and it was used to plow or to pull a cart or to pull some other types of loads. Yokes were also used for humans to carry heavy loads. And because of its association with labor and burden, the yoke was often used figuratively in the Bible to symbolize domination or control or submission. Oftentimes, the Bible used the word when you put your yoke on your shoulder, when you subjected yourself to somebody else. You know, the people put a yoke of labor on, Solomon put a yoke of labor on the people of Israel when they built the temple and his palace. It was also oftentimes considered punishment. In Deuteronomy, in the covenant, God says that if you disobey this covenant and the curses come upon you, I will put an iron yoke upon you for punishment and destruction. The Pharisees talked about the yoke of the law, the yoke which were put on people so that they could follow after God. And in Acts 15:10, as the believers and the apostles are talking about the yoke of the law, as Gentile believers are becoming Christians, they were arguing about, do we need to tell all the Gentile believers whether or not they need to put the yoke of the law upon themselves? Paul argues, why are you putting God to the test by placing on the neck of the disciples a yoke that neither our ancestors nor we have been able to bear? When Jesus invites us to come to him, he invites us into a special relationship with him. He invites us to put his yoke upon us and to become his disciple. Are we simply removing one yoke to put on another yoke? No, in the sense, yes, we are putting on the yoke of Jesus. But you got to remember a couple things. We are putting on the yoke of Jesus, who is more unique than any other person ever in this world. Jesus is the master that we submit ourselves to. And listen to what he says about himself. He goes, yes, you're putting on my yoke, but I am gentle and humble in heart. And he goes, and the yoke that you're putting on, that I'm putting on you, that yoke is easy. And the word for easy, it can also be translated kind or well-fitted. What Jesus invites us into is a unique relationship with him. And it is unique because when Jesus invites us to put that yoke upon him, rather than us do the labor, Jesus is the master who has done the labor for us. Jesus is giving a prototype of what that gospel invitation is to all of our lives. He is the gentle and humble master who humbled himself to the point of dying on a cross for our sins. What is the gospel? The gospel is the simple message that we on our own cannot do it. And God knew that, so God sent Jesus, what? To do the hard work for us. And so when we struggle with our sin and are weary by it, Jesus says, I have paid for your sin on that cross. When we compare ourselves to other people, Jesus says, you don't need to compare yourself to other people, because when God sees you, he sees me, and that's the only comparison that matters. when we are striving to measure ourselves by what we do, Jesus says it's not about what you do, but it's about what I have done for you. And that work is done. It's complete. Put my yoke upon you because I am doing the work when you put your Jesus' yoke upon your shoulders. And he goes, that burden is light. That burden is light. Yes, he has expectations upon our lives. But the way that Jesus puts it is in a way that is actually not burdensome. 1 John 5:3 says, in fact, this is the love of God. This is love for God, to keep his commands, and his commandments are not burdensome. How can Jesus do that? How can Jesus say that? There's a friend of mine who shared with me a story of how he was adopted. He had been abandoned by his parents, and through no circumstances of his own, as a child, he had kicked around from foster family to foster family, receiving a lot of abuse, bad situations. And he shared with me the story of how he came to his family. At that point in his life, you know, he was not a Christian, but he would pray to God, God, just give me a family that will not beat upon me and that'll feed me. That was just a prayer of this boy's heart. And he says he remembered that day the social worker took him to his new family, and he was just praying in his heart, God, you know, may they keep me and may they not beat me and may they just feed me. And he says he arrived at that house, and he was surprised to see on the front of the house a big sign that said, Welcome home, Todd, was his name. And when the social worker went up and introduced him to his father, who his new, you know, foster father, who was the first one to greet him, you know, he put out his hand just hoping that, you know, he would not be rejected. And the man just came and gave him a big bear hug and said, Welcome to the family. And they went in, and all the kids were home, and they'd invited over family to throw a big welcome home party for my friend Todd. And he says that as he was oriented to that house, they began sharing with him, you're going to share this room with your brothers here, and these are the family chores that we're going to have you do. And one of the unique things that he said about that story was, you know, in all the other places that he went, he was worked hard, and he had a lot of chores, and out of fear, he did all of these chores. When he arrived in his new family, at first he did these chores out of fear that they would reject him. But as he began to see the nature of the new father and mother he had received and the new family that he had received, he goes, those chores and being a part of that family, whatever obligations there was upon his life, they became joy. Why? Because they were not burdensome, but they were an invitation to be a part of something. We are tired and we are weary, many of us. And the summer is an invitation to reset. Some of us, if you're physically tired, it's not that complicated. Go on vacation and do something restful. Some of us need to look at the priorities in our life and rearrange that so that we have time for rest and solitude and the things that are life-giving in our lives. Some of us who are mentally and emotionally worn down, we need to learn to create boundaries, healthy boundaries in our lives. We need to learn to support, to find support from other people in our lives and join support groups if needed. And for those of us who are spiritually worn down and weary, we need a reset in our lives. And it's Jesus who invites us to come to him. It's Jesus who comes to us and says, hey, don't you get it? I'm the one who is the giver of life. I'm the one who strengthens you. I'm the one who calls you into this special relationship where it's not about what you do, but it's about what I've done for you and who you are. We need to be reminded of how much Jesus has done for us. I want to end with a little confession about preaching. When I first started out in ministry and began preaching, I remember it used to be just so burdensome, and I'd continually beat myself up over my sermons. And finally, I asked an older mentor one day who I thought was a phenomenal preaching. I said, how do you do it? You know, how do you? And I was hoping that he'd give me exegetical tips or planning or communication tips. And he goes, John, I got the secret to good preaching. I said, really? And, you know, pulled out my pen ready to take notes. He goes, it's really simple, John. He goes, before I preach, I simply remind myself of one thing. It's like, what do you remind yourself of? And he goes, I say to myself every time before I preach, right before I go up to the pulpit, God is well pleased with you. And he goes, and I say that to myself because even if I fall flat on my face and put everybody to sleep, God is still well pleased with me. And he goes, even if I should start the third great awakening and raise the roof, it doesn't matter. God is still well pleased with me. He does not judge me by how I do, but he judges me by what Jesus has done for me. That's true for all of our lives. Jesus invites us, come to me, all who are laboring and weary, all who are heavy laden and burdened. Come to him, for he is the source of life, and he is the source of the rest that so many of us long for. He says, put my yoke upon me, upon you, and become my disciple. Learn from me, for he's gentle and humble in heart, and his yoke is easy, and his burden is light. It's well-fitted. It gives us the significance that we need. And he says, and I will give you rest for your souls. Would you join me in prayer? Thank you, Heavenly Father, for being the one who gives us rest for our souls. You know where we're at. And Lord, we thank you that you are the source of life. Jesus, we thank you for what you have done for us. We pray that this summer might be one of just renewal for us, one of many vacations for people that need it, one of rest for people that need it, one of recommitment and renewal for many of us that need it, one of priority resetting for those of us who need it. In every way, Lord, would you just help us reset our summer in you? In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.